people a little more time to join in. If you just joined, if you want to just go ahead and introduce yourselves in the chat, we'll be capturing all of this on video, and also parts of today's conversation will be available on our website after we do some clips or we collect some clips from this. So we have 53 participants, and I think, JeffriAnne, what do you think, one more minute before we get started?
Yeah, let's wait another minute or so to allow more folks to get on. It seems like that there are folks joining our conversation by the second, so.
Okay, since we have so many people on the call, I've set it up so everybody's muted. That way we can hear the speaker. If you have a question, feel free to either, once we get to that portion of today's conversation, you can either drop it on the chat or unmute yourself and feel free to ask your question when you're ready, when we get to that point. I think I'm gonna start sharing my screen in a minute. My name is Johnny Fernandez. I'm the director of the K-12 Alliance at NCWIT, as well as our Tecnologicas program. We're here joined today by Dr. JeffriAnne Wilder, who will be co-facilitating mostly facilitating today's conversation. I'll just go ahead and get that screen shared so we can get started, and we'll let folks kind of jump in and join as time goes by.
So was that passing the baton to me, Johnny, officially?
Passing the baton officially, yes.
All right. Welcome everyone. I am JeffriAnne Wilder. I am on the social science team here at NCWIT, and Johnny and I think the rest of us at NCWIT are so excited to have you all here today to join us in our Color of Our Future conversation series. So today is the first installment of that series as we focus on Black girls in the K-12 space. Here's our agenda. We've already welcomed everyone, and I'm going to give a brief overview of our series before I introduce our panelists. We're going to spend most of our time, obviously, on a conversation related to Black girls in the K-12 space. I just want to make sure that take the opportunity to make sure everyone is muted.
I didn't hear what you said. I'm sorry.
So we will spend some time, of course, most of our time talking about some of the pressing issues, experiences related to broadening the participation of girls in the K-12 space. After that point, we will open it up for questions. Johnny also mentioned this a moment ago, but as we are going through our conversation today, please feel free to drop a question or comments within the chat. We are saving about 10 to 15 minutes at the end of the conversation to address some of those items. Also, feel free during that time to raise your hand virtually to ask a question or to make a comment. So with that, we will get started. If we can go to the next slide, please. So just a little bit about this series. As I mentioned a moment ago, I don't know how many folks know this, but today is the International Day of Women and Girls in Science. And so when we were thinking about planning this series and planning this conversation, we thought that today would be a perfect day to launch this series. The call of our future, we plan on examining important questions related to broadening the participation of Black women and girls in computing. We recognize that most of you all are probably familiar with NCWIT. If you're not familiar with NCWIT, our goal is simply to make sure that we are getting as many women and girls, broadening the meaningful and influential participation of women and girls in computing. This particular conversation series focuses on women and girls of color. And we'll spend, over the course of today and on through the middle of next month. February, of course, is Black History Month. Next month is Women's History Month. Today, we'll be spending our time talking about the K-12 space. In 2 weeks on February 27th, I believe, we're going to be devoting our conversation to Black women in the higher education space. And then finally, on Thursday, March 12th, we'll be looking at Black women in the tech industry. So the goal of this conversation series really is about celebrating and advocating and empowering Black women and girls across the space to ensure that we can, of course, enhance the experiences of Black women and girls across the entire tech ecosystem. Next slide, please. So just to tee up our conversation before I turn it over to our panelists, just a few important statistics related to K-12 computing. As it relates particularly to girls of color and in particular Black girls. And so I pulled a few really important data points from the Women of Color and Computing Data Brief from the Kapor Center. We'll be forwarding these slides on to folks if you're interested, and there's a link directly there. Just a couple important points here before we start our conversation. So nearly half of female students in K-12 education are girls of color, and that's no surprise given where we stand as a nation as it relates to underrepresented racial and ethnic minorities. And in 40 years, by 2060, there are projections that women of color will comprise the majority of the female population in the U.S. Again, these stats are no surprise given where we stand as a nation as it relates to racial and ethnic minorities. However, here's the point. This is where we need to be concerned, and this is where our conversation begins. Given that representation of girls of color within the K-12 educational system, very small percentages of those girls are actually engaging and taking involved in participating in computer science education. So just 4% of all high school students are taking the AP computer science courses in 2007 were Latinx, 2% were Black girls, and less than 1% were Native American and Alaskan Native girls. I mean, that's just taking sitting for the AP computer science exam. Obviously, we know the computer science education is much, much broader than that. And we also know that it's much bigger than just the high school level. That looking at broadening access and participation starts, of course, sometimes early as pre-K. And so in order to solve this gap, we know that it starts in the K-12 space. We spend a lot of time, folks spend a lot of time talking about the post-secondary education space, which is of course important, but we need to start the conversation much, much earlier. So the Bureau of Labor Statistics reports that every year, US companies are adding 500,000 new tech jobs every single year. But we know that there is a huge shortage when it comes to folks who are earning degrees, and computer course is very important. But in order to get to the degree attainment, we need to make sure that we are exposing as many girls of color and girls from underrepresented spaces way before they get to college. So that's important. Next slide. How do we get girls engaged even before they get to the point of taking AP or even get into high school and getting exposed to computer science classes? We know the research tells us that encouragement is extremely important, and of course our panel is going to be talking a little bit more about that here shortly. But just one point here about the role of encouragement. Newsflash, is really, really important, right? So we know that boys tend to receive a lot more encouragement from than girls across the board when it relates to exposure to computer science, but teachers, parents, and also the media. And we know, so the downside of that is that, you know, girls aren't getting enough encouragement, but the flip side of that is that that's very easy to turn around. It's very easy to encourage more girls to get involved in CS education, also computing. And in NCWIT, we spend a lot of time, developing and providing resources for folks to do that. So encouragement becomes really, really important. Next slide, please. Which brings us to today's conversation. So as I mentioned at the top of the hour, The Color of Our Future is a three-part conversation series about ways in which to celebrate, empower, and encourage more Black girls into computing. But this initiative doesn't stop with this three-part conversation. The Color of Our Future is a broader initiative here at NCWIT because we understand that computing pathways is a way to bridge the gap. You can bridge the economic, the social, the political, and cultural gap for women and girls of color now and on into the future. And so we are looking at The Color of Our Future as a broader organizational strategy where we anchor our programs, our initiatives, and of course our research-based resources that are focused on broadening, as I mentioned before, the meaningful and influential participation of underrepresented women and girls of color, that's Black, Latinx, and Native Americans, so we can positively impact the future of computing. And so with that, I would like to introduce today's panelists as we jump into our conversation. And so I'm thinking, I know folks are muted, so I'm just going to introduce folks, and then as we get into our first question, I'll allow all of our panelists to talk a little bit more about who they are and what they do. Joining us from NCWIT is TJ Aladdin. She is a Community Engagement Manager with Aspirations. Aravana Ashan is a Curriculum Specialist for Black Girls Code. Dion Gordon is the president of Tech Birmingham. Deborah Kariuki is a faculty member in STEM education at the University of Maryland, Baltimore County. And finally, we are excited, and of course, we're excited to have all of our panelists, but we are really excited that Taylor Richardson, who is an 11th grader, was able to take time out of her school day, although I know that probably didn't twist her arm too much, to join us for our conversation. Taylor's also known as Astronaut Starbright, and she is a phenom. She's a student, activist, advocate, and philanthropist, and I will allow her to tell the group more about what she does. And with that, I'll jump into our first question for all of our panelists. And we would like all of our panelists to answer this question if possible, and feel free to jump in and turn take as you see fit. But again, today's conversation is really about empowering, celebrating, and looking at how important it is to have more Black girls in tech. So by way of introduction, if we could have all of our panelists share with us the specific work that you're doing to broaden the participation of Black girls in tech.
I can go first because I don't want to go after Taylor. It's going to be hard to surpass that. Hi, everyone. I'm TJ. I work with Johnny, and I focus on our community of about 15,000 now technical women. The program started back in 2006. We only had at that time about 15 members of our community. And the way that we gathered them in was through a high school award, which we still run till this day. And that award is basically focused on sort of helping girls around the nation to learn more about tech. So it's not based on, you know, how much you've done. It's more based on, like, you know, do you have an interest in tech? So we started with 15, and now we have about 15,000. And each year we give about 4,000 awards to girls nationwide around the country. There are a large number of other programs that we do, but I'll stop there to give other folks a chance to talk as well.
And the program that TJ is talking about is called Aspirations. Yes, it's one of our signature programs at NCWIT. And TJ, I know you probably thought you said Aspirations since you probably say it at least 10,000 times a day, right?
Yes, thank you for that.
Hello, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay, hi. Well, hello, my name is Taylor Richardson. I'm 16 years old and I attend the Bowl School in Jacksonville, Florida. Most people know me as Astronaut Starbright, and I personally use crowdfunding to raise funds to send to girls to STEM camp that focus on space, robotics, and aviation. I also have a Taylor's Take Flight with a book drive where I collect and donate STEM, you know, what does it say? STEM about books to children in underserved areas locally and nationally, so they can have home libraries and read themselves and hopefully learn more. And yeah, that's pretty much it. I also speak at different organizations like Elevate Network for Women and IBM and stuff like that to hopefully promote representation for girls, especially girls of color in STEM. So nice to meet all you guys.
I'm going to interject here for a moment if I could. Taylor, you're being way too modest. If you could just also share with us the type of folks that you've been a part that who have partnered with you to advance the space of Black girls in STEM. I think people would be very impressed and excited to hear about some of the folks you've worked with in the past.
So basically through my crowdfunding, I've partnered with Oprah Winfrey, JJ Abrams, Beyonce, a lot of people who love my message about promoting Black girls in STEM, and they donated a lot towards my campaign, along with helping me with workshops for girls here locally in Jacksonville, along with Black Girls Who Code, who I met at a, I think we were on the same panel at a Disney premiere or something like that. Yeah, so I've met her, and yeah, I think that's pretty much it.
JeffriAnne, Taylor just said Oprah and Beyonce. I think we can all go home now.
Yeah, she also, she forgot Ava DuVernay. And let me go ahead. I mean, I'm, right. That's important. And when
Miss
the
film,
right. And when the films A Wrinkle in Time and Hidden Figures premiered, that was a big piece of Taylor's crowdsourcing to make sure that there were theaters filled with young Black girls who could see role models and faces who look like them doing really big things in STEM.
Yes. Yes. Thank you so much.
All right, that's going to be difficult to follow. So this is Deborah Karaoke, and I'm actually a UMBC computer science faculty preparing teachers to teach computer science. And what I do to broaden participation of girls in tech is I go to several different clubs. Since these days I'm not in the classroom, I was a classroom teacher, and before then I was a software engineer. Before I decided maybe getting involved with the girls and actually training them to become computer science majors was the best thing to do. But now I'm preparing teachers so that we can even reach more people. But really what I spend time doing is I do go to Girls Who Code. I speak there. I go to Black Girls Who Code, Girls in Cyber. It's called Girls First in Cyber. And this on the 22nd here in Baltimore, just because of the statistics that we just had, very few Black girls are doing computer science. are actually doing the AP exam. I also found out that very few of them are actually applying for the NCWIT Aspiration Award or any of these other awards that they're supposed to get involved with. So what I'm doing is on the 22nd of February, I'm going to go to Baltimore and I'm going to talk to girls about those tools that they need and that they can use so that they can also participate, because we need to reach them where they are and show them all the other things that are available. So those are some of the things that I'm doing, and I will talk some more later.
Fantastic. Thank you, Deborah.
Well, hi, I'm going to jump in. My name is Aradne Shun. I am the curriculum specialist for Black Girls Code. I manage technical education programs and platforms that like enable the development and growth across our tech divas and our alumni. I work closely like in holistic development when thinking about how we're enforcing the skills and experiences to our girls, but also work with technical companies and technical volunteers to provide the resources and the access to like our educational structure, right? They are the future. So definitely that is what I do with Black Girls Code, the curriculum specialist. But also, I have a nonprofit in Ghana too. I'm just introducing students and the community and the children to STEM, along with providing them resources, right? It's very important. For Black Girls Code, we have a chapter in South Africa in which we do the same thing, enforcing our programs over there. So just wanting to be mindful of how we're cultivating the next generation and really providing that platform for young girls in STEM, young Black girls in STEM.
Awesome.
So I have the terrible task of following all of that, nonprofits in Ghana and Beyonce. So I will readily accept my defeat, but I'm Dion Gordon. I'm pleased to serve as the president of Tech Birmingham. It's our local technology council. At the end of the day, it's really simple. We just want to make sure that we're promoting Birmingham as an emerging and an inclusive tech hub that ties directly in line with one of the goals of the mayor, in fact, is to make sure that we are elevating the city as the hub of inclusive tech for women and minority business owners and entrepreneurs. And as it relates to the technology ecosystem, again, there is a disconnect, I believe, in what we are building in Birmingham, but I think we also have an opportunity to really set the model for how we go about building those inclusive pipelines that are robust and responsive. And to kind of further unpack what I mean by that, one of the mission pillars, if you will, is for us to increase just the capacity of the ecosystem. So that means bringing in outside companies, but also recognizing that we have a massive talent pool right here in our own backyards. And if we're really to stumble on that path to sustainability, we have to make sure that we're elevating our educational institutions and as well as our CTE institutions and alternative opportunities, if you will, and boot camp programming, and of course further aligning that with four-year institutions. And some of the learnings that are coming out of that experience is I want to make sure I'm framing it up properly, but just how often we miss the basics. For instance, we facilitated through our lead industry partner a device grant where 13 city schools received about 400 devices. And a lot of these initiatives really never stop to think that educators also have to be lifted up to deliver the curriculum. They have to be comfortable with the devices. They have to make sure that it aligns with state standards. And so there's just so much more that goes into delivering computer science and programming than just delivering devices or just rolling out the curriculum. And so we're trying to adopt a holistic lens, especially as it relates to Black girls in this space. And so we're also looking at differentiated learning, recognizing that individuals might learn and take to this information in different ways. Some prefer the more didactic model. Some want to do what we're identifying as paired programming, being able to look over the shoulder of others. Some want more of a support group. And so with all of that said, we really see our role in this space as having our finger on the pulse and being able to connect the different dots. We were very intentional about making sure we did not recreate wheels. We wanted to be a collaborator and not a competitor. I think, for instance, some of our best work is in when we play that support role. Birmingham Black Techies is a group that just started by a wonderful individual, Nisha White, and she just recognized that nothing like that existed to elevate and celebrate Blacks in technology. And so our role, of course, is not to lend our weight and our voice and our brand, but it's just we don't want to overshadow, it's to support and lift up what she's doing. And that's the approach that we've been adopting with a lot of other organizations as well.
Well, that's fantastic. And I think, just thank you all so much for these wonderful introductions about the work that you're doing in various spaces across the tech ecosystem. And I think this sets us up very nicely for our next question that we can have either all or some of our panelists respond to. So we're, of course, our conversation is focused on the K-12 space. And Deanne, you just mentioned some really important things related to foundational basic things around learning. So how can we make our learning environment, whether that's formal or informal, more conducive to bringing more Black girls in? So what can we do in our formal or informal environments to get more Black girls included and embracing CS foundations? And sort of just a tag along to that, how does that look like? What does that look like in the pre-K through five space in particular? So, feel free to respond to that.
Yeah. I'll jump in just briefly. My background is in entrepreneurship and lean, let's say, space and that opportunity. And so one of the things that we do in our work with Birmingham City Schools is just to lean on them because they are closest to the opportunities. And so they will be the best position to tell us what a particular school or a particular district really needs. And then it's our job to come through and really lend support to that. So one of the outcomes from these initial engagements will be an after school program specifically for Black girls, just basically an enrichment club. Where they'll be able to come together. But from that, we get for these kids to go home and still continue their learning. Do we have broadband access issues that we now need to start appreciating? Will there be transportation barriers that we need to start appreciating? Again, kind of going back to the differentiated learning model, are there any gaps and hurdles just around the adoption and the use of technology? As we were kind of unrolling some of this work and traveling across the state and talking to other institutions, a lot of schools just admitted that they have closets full of devices that they have not deployed. And kudos to the teachers who still try to navigate and operate within those challenges, especially doing unplugged programming activities just to encourage computational thinking and kind of get these kids familiar with it. But there are still significant IT barriers. And so we've been able to really lean on some of our partners, Apple in particular, to send us resources, people who can come down and help facilitate some of those learnings and educational opportunities, not just for the educators, but also for the IT administrators, also for the parents. Again, he's recognizing that all of this touches a variety of segments, right, from the parents all the way down to the kids. So that's something that we're really trying to roll out. Of course, again, recognizing that we are in research mode and we're trying to be active learners in this space.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. I'm going to jump in.
No, go ahead.
I'm going to say, so informal, right? Put together strategies that gauge participation in intentionally for us, right? But unintentionally for them. So for example, let's say there's a break or recess. You could just leave broken down robot pieces, right? And the instructions on the table, leave it there and see how young girls gravitate towards it. Many hands-on projects. Like think in that way, very abstract way to gain participation so that it's a normal thing, right? Formal, introduce students to the foundational elements so that they understand like why it works, how it works. And then that's how you can pivot from the informal, right, to the formal and do certain things like that so that it's more of a natural thing. How that looks like in pre-K, for Black Girls Code, we go as young for some of our programs, first grade, right? But we have our standard model as workshops. Sometimes we have Saturday workshops where the girls come in and they learn a specific topic. But Dion mentioned something initially. He said paired programming, right? How are we pairing them together so that they're learning off of each other and encouraging one another to like grow, right? So a lot of the girls that we have, sometimes they'll come and they're unsure, right? They don't know web development. They don't know programming. They don't know how to put together a robot or what that is. But having that community around them and active volunteers to say, hey, it's okay, you don't need to know anything. Just come into this space, right? And let's do it together. That's very powerful when you're thinking about how they are embracing these new topics or even these foundational elements of whatever we're teaching them, right? So that's a little take.
Well, yeah. Hi, Taylor again. Just to piggy off what you said, as a high school student, I think that workshops in our communities and internships for high school girls and scholarships and things like that would also help us get, you know, hands-on activities, like you were saying, with technology and to keep funding programs like Black Girls Code, who are already doing the work and changing the face of tech. And I don't know, I don't think we have a Black Girls Code in Jacksonville, to my knowledge, but I do know there needs to be more programs like Black Girls Who Code that can really represent and bring inclusivity to technology for Black women and girls.
All right, as far as pre-K to five, actually, I think we should go more from pre-K to three. Those students, we really are not really teaching them programming, you know? We are trying to introduce them more to computational thinking and have be more playful experiences because we don't want to make this another job of them of having something to complete. So having computational thinking, having them do steps, and then you introduce what those steps are. You introduce the language of what they have just done. Having those toys that are going to move a certain steps and maybe use those as part of an addition class. And then have another robot, maybe the robot is dancing or some lights. So you're introducing a little bit of more of the curriculum like science and all that. And then from three to five, you can introduce some of those coding using some programming like the drag and drop Scratch, very playful things. So they are actually like making their own little story. So a student wants to have a story, let them create it through some robots that are going to talk but on the screen. So that's what I would say that I see mostly with pre-K as an educator for teachers. That's what I would see. But I really don't have that much experience with the pre-K to five. I will talk later when we talk about the high school kids and college.
Well, for someone without a whole lot of experience, you really offered some really important things for us, Deborah, so we really appreciate that. And I love this idea that it seemed like almost everyone, all the panelists talked about this notion of normalizing, you know, CS foundations, introducing things like computational thinking really, really early. Because when we think about, you know, what a computer scientist looks like or what someone who codes looks like, we know most of the time that it doesn't necessarily reflect Black girls, and it's important to ensure that we're doing things to normalize that. Which brings us to our third question, which centers on the idea of encouragement. So we know, and I shared some stats earlier about how important it is to encourage girls, particularly underrepresented girls of color. What role have you seen encouragement play in getting more Black girls involved in computing? And what advice, let's kind of focus in here because I think we've already spoken to the first part of this question. What advice would you give to Black girls interested in pursuing a career in computing? Is that different than the advice you would give to Black boys?
All right, I am going to jump into this one because this is my area. You know, I love that. Yeah, you know, I love that. But giving advice to girls is so important. Most of the girls that I taught in high school who had no idea what was computer science or what they could do with it, but showing them some of the projects that I worked on when I was at IBM and showing them what programming can do, showing them that programming is in medicine, it's in art, it's in music, and advising them that when you do any of these subjects, it doesn't mean that you're going to sit behind the screen day in, day out, and it's not boring. There's a lot of interesting things you can do. And also bringing people to talk with them, you know, the role models, showing them people who do that. And I used to beg and plead and be able to take them to industry so that they could meet people and they could talk with them. And I'm proud to say I have several girls now working for Microsoft and Google and other places. And all of them, they all tell me, like I texted them some of these questions and they all say, it's because you talked to us and you encouraged us, and also giving my background. And that's for another time. I did computer science without ever knowing what was a computer. So just letting them know you can do it and it's possible. You just have to want, because you're already doing calculus, you're already doing physics. It's not any more difficult than physics or calculus or chemistry. So that advice, handholding them, exposing them to people who have done this, is the same. And with the boys too, especially boys with color, I really give them the same information. And also I give them time, you know, opening my room in the morning, after school, during the weekend, inviting parents. So that kind of exposing them. So for me, the advice I gave the boys or the girls was not different. And it's because I had groups of kids who didn't know anybody who had done computer science. So I give them the same information.
I'd like to just chime in here. And I wonder if we can move to slide 20, Johnny. Because this is exactly what we do with the high school award, is that we just tell girls, yes, you can do this. Yes, this is something that is for you. It's not an award that's based on the grade you got or the courses you took or the robot you built. It's more just you know, spark or like an interest in like CS, and they get to come to this event and meet other girls who are just like them. And so it's not a matter of like, you know, teaching them these actual skills, but just saying like, hey, did you know about this? And in most cases, as you can see from these quotes, they had no idea. And once we just open that door, it, you know, their minds open up to so much more than what they thought like, you know, prior. And then with boys, I'll say, because we do sometimes have, you know, mixed gender events. And with boys, I think the only difference is that when they're in a room hearing about, you know, tech for girls and all this stuff for girls, sometimes they might feel like, oh, what about me? And I think it's great to let them know that they also have a role to play, not just for their own future in tech, but to make sure that people aren't left out. And so I think it's great to, you know, give the same message to both boys and girls as well.
TJ, that's awesome. I agree with that too. I would say encouragement plays a big part. Number one, starting from parents. For our workshops, we see parents, dads, you have moms, you have big sisters really coming in and signing these girls up to just be a part of this community so that they see other Black girls that are coding, are programming, and are engaged and happy to learn with them, right? Happy or unhappy, right? But at the end of the day, they'll come out happy. It'll be so surprising. With number one, the parents, right? Number two, volunteers. How are our technical assistants, our non-technical assistants, our teachers really providing that atmosphere, that comfortable atmosphere to have These girls do amazing things after the workshop or during the workshop. In regards to advice with Black girls interested in pursuing a career in computing, the one, Black girls, there's money there, right? Second, if you want to learn, it's not by force. With development, if you're not really engaged, you could get easily lost. So the question is whether you're an artist, right? You can find some way to incorporate technology into it, right? It's how can you bring life or your interest into technology and then work well with that? That's very important. Because there's other elements in regards to not only software engineering, software development, there's so many aspects of tech that's definitely relatable. So I would say that also communities like Black Girls Code, how are you engaging? How are you jumping into different, like, there's a lot of things we can say in regards to that, but having that community, having these programs, having your parents, right? It starts at home too for most students as well. Teachers. We have students that go to school every single day. That's they're spending more time with teachers and in the schools than really their regular parents, right? How would they set in that tone? So it's definitely important in regards to encouragement, but it helps as the students transition from kindergarten to fifth grade to high school to college, right? To maybe a job after. So it's definitely something to look at as well.
I
was just going to say some advice I would give to Black girls interested in pursuing a career in computing is to just do it and don't let anything hold them back. I would say, I don't know, I feel like personally people think that, I don't know, I would say let them know that you're capable of whatever you put your mind to remember to stay connected to the essence of who you are, to take care of yourself along the way, but to reach out to others and just pause and wonder and think to yourself that I can do this and connect to a place within yourself and not just for yourself, for other Black girls too. And my advice for boys would probably be the exact same, but just to be our ally and not our fixer. People have this impression that we need fixing and we don't. We can do this on our own and by ourselves. We just need a place to stand and encouragement along the way. So that's just my personal view.
And fantastic. And again, I'll be brief. I heard something earlier that made me think about some opportunities that we are exploring, in particular with our kids' coding program that's designed to capture from middle to high school. And we do this once a month, and then we have some quarterly workshops. But what's important is that a lot of the parents, they do not leave their kids. They decide to stick around since it's only anywhere from an hour and a half to 3 hours for most engagements. And so now we're starting to explore opportunities for multi-generational programming opportunities to get the parents involved as well. The idea being that they'll be able to take those experiences back into the household, and not only will they be more interested in these potential opportunities for their kid, but they'll be able to speak with a bit more articulation, and they'll be able to recognize earlier whether or not that their child has a serious interest or what needs to be done to further that exploration along. The same way, if a kid sits behind the piano and they become some whiz kid when it comes to that, of course that parent is naturally going to say, we got to get this kid in some piano lessons. We have to further nurture whatever that talent, whatever their interest is. And I think this is an opportunity for us to apply that same thinking to computer science as well.
That's fantastic. I see that we have 70 folks who are part of the conversation, and that we have about 15 minutes left, and I don't want to not give folks time to chime in, comment on the things that we're talking about. So I'm gonna go ahead and skip question four and jump to our final question, which I think is probably really great for everyone on this call. So what can we do as a community? So women and girls of color and also allies, what can we do as an entire community to better leverage our strength and our collective work to ensure that we have a better representation of girls of color in tech? What can we do?
The first thing that we should do is to be out there. You know, we need to be seen. women, I'm sure many people do not know that there's so many PhD computer science women in this country. There'll be people who'll be so shocked that there's so many of them. So I don't think for the longest time we have been out there and letting the students and parents and anybody else know that women of color can do computer science, and they're there and they're doing great things. We see now a lot of history that is being posted about how successful women of color were since the 60s, since the 50s in this field of computer science. So as a collective group, we need to bring out more and more faces and let them be there. Maybe have them on TV, on videos, on pictures, and a lot more. So exposure, I think it's the biggest key. The other thing is to ensure that we're inviting girls, and we are also not just talking about money. Most girls are not in computer science just because of money. How can they help their society? Yes, it's good to have the money, but how is that going to help them and help their society? Most girls will be more impressed with that.
This is my one little soapbox, but I feel like as a community, we don't always do a great job of telling the full story. For example, I work directly with the women, and so I talk about the programming. And then when I leave out the research and when I leave out the workforce stuff, it misses the full picture and it tells the story just that, oh, if we just teach girls coding, it'll be fine. And we know very well that this is not the fix to the problem. So I think I would love to see us all talk more about the full scope of what needs to be done to change the problem and not just focus on, oh, well, let's talk about coding skills or let's talk about, workforce challenges. We have to tell the whole story. Otherwise, I think it gets sort of muddled and people don't recognize that all these pieces are a part of a larger strategy to fix the whole problem.
Okay, I'll jump in here too. Yeah, definitely in regards to data is essential, right? So piggyback off of what she said, in workshops, we see it's more powerful too to see how we can have Black women who are leaders and actually in the industry. We have women in tech panels sometime too, so that girls see representations of what the workforce looks like in positions like that. Also, jump into organizations again, like Black Girls Code and the Helping Hand. Volunteer, get your companies involved to volunteer if they're not able to provide monetary funds, right? Be the change you want to see, like one of the quotes I really love, and have fun doing it. I think someone mentioned before, normalize the idea of women in tech, normalize it and encourage girls. I think Taylor said that, encourage girls to just do it, right? Show that you can do whatever. In general, you can do whatever you set your mind to, right? So just definitely go out there. That's what I would say with everyone. If you want to normalize it, then it can be done, and you'll see the transition of girls just jumping into this space once they're comfortable and do more comfortable things that feel natural.
Sorry, I have one more. Don't ever believe me when I say I have one soapbox. The second thing and last thing I want to say about this is, like, there are different pathways to getting different types of people interested in tech. And I often hear people sort of yuck and yum different things, like, oh, tech and fashion is too girly, or just focus on pure tech and math. And I just want to say, like, no answer is the right answer. We are not all one being. Black girls and women like different things. And so don't push girls away from fashion, or don't only push them towards pink and purple, or just, focus on pure, math. I think all of these pathways should be out there because they're all valid pathways, because we need skills in all of these, different areas. And so even if it's not your thing, dance and science, or, music and science, whatever, just make sure that, if it's not your thing, that you still allow girls a pathway to those, many options that we have out there.
And briefly, I'll just say, I think I have a unique role, just as a male in this space. I am very sensitive about making sure I play a proper role, and that I support where I'm where I'm asked to support. Quite honestly, this involves usually me shutting up and letting smart people tell me what to do. I find that generally works best, but I do think it is just incumbent upon me in this role to make sure I am bringing a platform which is traditionally associated with a white male industry, for lack of a better way to put it, and to really flip that on its head, to look for opportunities to elevate individuals who can help us drive toward better representation. In particular, I'm thinking about individuals like Ashley Ammons and Carrie Schrader of Mixed Shows, and they have a wonderful story. They moved their company to Birmingham. Neither of them had a background in technology, and they were able to raise $1 million, 900,000 of which came from Birmingham, making them the 37th and the 38th Black female founders to do so. That number, of course, should be higher, but we just love talking about them, quite honestly. I think they're a great representation of what can happen when a community really leans in. And when that community does so in an authentic fashion, Birmingham is unapologetically Black. And I love the fact that as a community, everybody is looking at that as an asset, as a value. And of course, also leveraging our legacy in the human and civil rights movement. Pushing for positive disruption and inclusion. And I find it fitting that in so many ways, we're having that same conversation just this time around technology. So that's pretty much how I've approached it. How can I lend my voice in this platform to elevate others?
Hello. Well, as a student, I guess I would say, continue to find like coaches and mentors and professionals who look like us so we can see ourselves represented in a positive way. Like I always say, representation matters. And most importantly, we need those who look like us and those who don't to be willing to invest in us. Technology can be a powerful tool for transforming learning. And I think to fully realize the benefits of technology in our education system and to provide authentic learning experiences, educators specifically need to use technology effectively in their practice to have us have hands-on experiences and learn new things and kind of gravitate as a whole.
Yeah, definitely. Taylor, I would say that's well put. In regards to mentors play an important role when we're doing our special projects. Sometimes we have students come together, develop an app, then we'll have a mentor from maybe Pinterest. The last recent one we did was Pinterest and Apple. They came together to really work and prep.
Amazing.
To actually work and prep with the girls so that they strive for completion, right? So definitely representation matters and how you're engaging people in these companies, especially popular companies or small companies, right? Starting off, but so that everybody has their own story to tell and they're able to say there's different variations and different platforms where these students are able to engage in.
Of course.
Well, I knew that this hour was going to fly by, and we only have about 6 minutes left on our conversation. But what I'd like to do briefly is to pause here and highlight some of our K-12 resources. So for those folks who don't know, one of the things that we do at NCWIT is to provide hundreds of free online resources related to broadening participation in tech. We've got highlighted here some of our resources that are specific to the K-12 space, from highlighting our Modern Focus podcast, all the way down to Bridging the Encouragement Gap. So there are a number of resources that you can take advantage of online through these links, or just going to our website, ncwit.org, and clicking on resources and tools. That will take you to all of the variety of different resources that we have available for folks. So I see that there have been a few questions that have gone up in the chat. Johnny, I'm going to toss it over to you to see if you want to just maybe pick one or two of them to have some of our folks respond to.
Absolutely. And I'm going to stop sharing our screen so we can put faces with voices. I tried doing that earlier, and of course, technical difficulties here. So let's see. Are you able to see the Brady Bunch screen?
Yes, we are all Brady'd out.
Wonderful. So we have a question from Amy. She wanted to know, as a white woman, how can she reach a group of underrepresented girls? She only has one girl of color registered to her CS class, and she doesn't come to meetings. Any advice or insight as to what we can, something that we can share with Amy?
I think what Amy needs to do is she needs to be authentic herself, but she also needs to reach and know the interest of that student. Because if a student know you have their interest at heart, it doesn't matter what color the teacher is. They have to feel a connection. And maybe sometimes the teacher, if the teacher doesn't know the student very well, find out, does the student go to drama? Does the student know art? Does the student, what else is the student doing outside school, even a job? And if you get involved with that, with what they're doing outside, then you can get them in the field that you're inviting them. And also in class, when you give examples of an example of maybe we are not all making objects from cars. Let her come up with her own objects of her own cultural understanding. And that's how you bring girls to wanting to be around you or anybody. You know, we all want to do good with the people who, if anything similar with anybody else, so she's not going to show up because she doesn't feel like she belongs.
Yeah, Deborah, that was awesome. So I would say, number one, enforce cultural relevance, right? That's important. Number two, to bring it back to like BGC programming, I would have questions saying, hey, I'm a white woman, I don't know if I can come out and volunteer as a TI, TA. It's fine. I think once you're just providing that platform, that space, but also you already emphasized, Amy, that hey, you really want her to come to this class, right? But it goes back in, how are you just normalizing it? Know what her interest is, what all the girls' interest is, and how can you provide whatever your programming is, right? So there's so many awesome resources from NCWIT that I would have you go through, look through it, see, and utilize that and try to really bring things out in your programming, because just make it engaging and fun, right?
And just to add to that, we do have a community of about 15,000 women around the country. And so I'm sure that we have a woman in college, or you know, even close to me, like a senior in high school, who would be happy to come in and talk and share about her, you know, background and experiences. I just posted my email in the chat. So if you want to, you can reach out to me. I can try and connect you with someone. I think there's something to like the near peer, you know, communication that, even though sometimes I think I'm cool, I'm not at all cool. And so it's great to have someone come in and sort of bridge that gap as well.
I think that's great, TJ. And we're seeing lots of wonderful things, conversation in the chat related to our resources. And thanks so much, Ravana, for shouting out our resources again. So we have there was a question I think in the chat related to our work with minority serving institutions, and Kim Keller, who is our director of our academic alliance, mentioned that we are currently working with 97 MSI organizations, so HBCUs, Hispanic serving institutions, tribal colleges. We also have resources for our counselors through our Counselors for Computing community, so there are resources available there. One of our other social scientists brought up in the chat to check out NCWIT's engagement practices framework and the collection of peer-reviewed teaching materials for inspiration. So it's important for us to sort of highlight that all of our resources are research-based. I think that's something that's really important for us. Any final comments? One last thing from our wonderful panelists before we adjourn for the day.
No, when I say so much, it was a good opportunity, and thanks to talking with everybody else. I think the questions are good, and we we can answer any questions if anybody shoots you an email and they need to know, like, how did I increase my numbers of students and how did I have them succeed, get fives in computer science and going to college, they can reach out to you and I can give them some pointers so we can reach beyond the call.
Yeah, I want to thank everybody for, I guess, jumping on a call. It shows that you're really interested in how we're emphasizing Black women and Black girls in computing, right? We're trying to upscale this so that, again, you guys have been hearing this normalization word all through the hour. So we just want to create a beautiful and honest platform for our girls, right? When we're transitioning from Black Girls Code, now we have our students, they're alumni. They're juniors, right? We're following them now, going back to the data saying, hey, did you major in computer science? Or if you didn't, why not? Or how can we find some way to bring relevance to it if you're interested or not, right? These are all things that are important. And with all these technology jobs opening up, there is space for a young lady to dive into, right? Everybody on this chat, on this call, we're destined to be a pillar of growth. Right? We have to touch someone for them to be able to do more. So it shows that you're interested and just thanks for joining us on this panel.
Go ahead.
You can go.
No, I'll be super brief. I just wanted to say thanks to everybody for taking time on the call. Thanks for extending this invitation for me to participate. I really see this more as an opportunity for me to learn and to hopefully incorporate some things into Birmingham as well to build on what we've been doing. And I'll also offer up a thanks and appreciation to the folks over at NCWIT for engaging. Not just with Tech Birmingham, but the entire ecosystem and helping us really build out something that is stronger and more robust. So again, super appreciative. Thank you.
I just wanted to say thank you to everyone who took time out of the day to talk to me. And the panel was amazing, but also share their passion for Black girls to be in technology and also change the face of STEM. So I appreciate you guys and it was nice meeting you.
Thank you so much, Taylor, for joining us.
Thanks.
No problem.
I would just parting words. February 27th is our next series focusing on the post-secondary space. So please register and join us on the 27th for a continued conversation. So thank you very much, everybody, for being here today. JeffriAnne, any last thoughts?
International Day of Women's Thank you. Thank you, Johnny. Thank you, JeffriAnne. You got me.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Great day.
Great rest of your day.